2 Corinthians chapter 10 begins the final portion of the letter. You could divide it, as we've said, this letter into three parts. And the first part of it deals with the first seven chapters, wherein Paul describes the reasons why he was delayed in coming to Corinth, like he said he would at the end of 1 Corinthians. And then also his mild rebuke to the people for turning against him and listening to false teachers. More than a mild rebuke is also an outpouring of his disappointment and his sadness over how they have rejected him and rebelled against him. So the middle two chapters, chapters 8 and 9, constitute the crux of the letter, with him reminding them what to do in preparation for his arrival, whenever it may be. He's always going to get there. He was always going to arrive. It's just he's been delayed. But when he does arrive, they need to make sure that they are ready for him. And that concerned the giving, the collection that he was taking for those poor saints. Chapters 10, 11, 12, and 13, the final third of this great book, is Paul defending his apostleship and attacking directly these false teachers who have infiltrated the congregation. Now, he doesn't necessarily speak to them personally. He speaks to his brethren that he writes the letter to, but he speaks directly about them. Whereas in the first part of the letter, when he talked about the false teachers, it was more rebuking them for listening to them. Now he is rebuking them by telling them, his brethren, how wrong these false teachers are. And so that begins chapter 10, which starts with Paul saying, "Now I, Paul, myself, beseech you by the meekness and gentleness of Christ." Among the things that they accused Paul was being weak, and he says, "I'm not weak, I'm meek. And I beseech you with the meekness of Christ, with the gentleness of Christ, who in present," Paul says of himself, "in presence I am base among you, low, and absent and bold towards you." That seems to be what they said about him, as we'll get to later in the chapter. They said, "Oh, his letters are big and bold and powerful, but his bodily presence when he's actually standing face to face with you isn't much to write home about." And so they use that against him. And he says, "I write to you with the meekness of Christ, though I am seemingly base, brought down when I'm in your presence, but seemingly bold in my letter. I still approach you the same, whether in person or in letter, with the gentleness and meekness of Christ. But I beseech you that I may not be bold when I am present with that confidence, wherewith I think to be bold against some, which think to us as if we walked according to the flesh." Here he speaks of these false teachers. There's a lot of sarcasm and blunt language he uses in this final text, chapters 10 through 13, and you see a little bit of it here, the way he talks about these false teachers. "I beseech you, I may not be bold when I'm present," that's what they say, "with that confidence wherewith I think to be bold against some. I may not be bold with you, but I certainly could be bold against them if they provoke my authority and wrath as an apostle. Those who think of us as if we walked according to the flesh." They try to say of us that we are worldly minded, but it is them who are the worldly minded ones, as he'll say later. "For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war after the flesh. I am a physical being, but I belong to a spiritual kingdom. My fight is not a physical one, but a spiritual one. I may be in the world, but I am not of the world." So it's not him who is worldly, it's them who are worldly. They're the ones trying to bind circumcision, a physical surgical procedure, on brethren as a prerequisite to spiritual salvation. They're the worldly minded ones, not Paul. Verse 4, he continues talking about his ministry. "For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. My fight is a spiritual one. My weapon, therefore, is a spiritual one. My fight is not like the world fights." These false teachers, they're attacking Paul personally, whereas Paul is rebuking their doctrine. Who is fighting like the world, and who is fighting a spiritual battle? He says he, verse 5, "cast down imaginations and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God. He brings into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ." His battle is for minds, not for bodies. He fights not to tear down buildings or destroy cities, as modern warfare is, but rather he says he fights against imaginations, false teaching, false ideas against the truth. He fights to keep in captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ, not to imprison people in physical jails, as he once did in a previous life, but rather to bring to captivity the thoughts to Christianity. Verse 6, and having in a readiness to revenge all disobedience when your obedience is fulfilled. How do you fight against unrighteousness and untruths, namely theirs, these false teachers? You stand with the truth. You stand with righteousness. You stand with obedience. And so he says, I have the authority. If you want to test me, I can show you my authority as an apostle. But I would prefer that you just simply obey Christ so that I don't have to. Verse 7. Do we look on things after the outward appearance? Oh, Paul is so small. He's so pathetic when you see him in person. But privately, he writes these big weighty letters. But in person, he is not much to look at. Well, are you looking at the outward appearance? Or are you looking at the content of a person's character? Not the look of their skin or their outward presence. He says, these false teachers, they have honey dripping off the lips, but their words are still lies. We don't look after the outward appearance. If any man trusts himself that he is Christ, you claim you belong to him, let him of himself think this again, that he is Christ, even so we are Christ. You claim to be followers of Christ, yet you look on the outward appearance to judge a man outwardly? That's not very Christian. Verse 8. For though I should boast somewhat more of our authority, which the Lord has given us for edification, I should not for your destruction. I should not be ashamed. I could use my power and abuse my power. Flippantly, I could use it. I could constantly be striking people dead or striking people blind, and that would be wrong of me. I don't seek to do that. My boasting, I could boast of my own authority, which was given to me for your edification, for your growth in the Spirit, but I don't want to do that. I would rather you just hear my words and believe them as authoritative and inspired of God. Don't push me, he says. Don't test me. Don't provoke me to showing you my authority. Verse 9, here's some sarcasm. Though I might not that I may not seem as if I would terrify you by letters. Oh, I don't mean to scare you with my big bold letters and be insignificant in presence. I want my letters to be infiltrating the mind, not determining what you think of me by appearance. I want you to read my words and hear my words, whether it's in presence or in letter, and see that I'm telling you the truth. And don't listen to these false teachers who are trying to judge outwardly. Verse 10, for his letters, they say, are weighty and powerful, but his bodily presence is weak, his speech contemptible. Paul apparently spoke kind of meekly, to use it in a negative sense, though it's not a negative word, the way they're using it is. He speaks all weak, he speaks all pathetic, he speaks maybe even kind of with a stutter, with kind of a stammer, But his letters are weighty and powerful, they say. So something is not right. Paul must be a hypocrite. No, my words, however they come out and whatever form they take, are truth. And they are right to be believed and obeyed. My bodily presence, my persona is irrelevant. Verse 11. And shame on them for attacking me for it, he says. Verse 11. Let such a one think this, that such as we are in word by letters when we are absent, such we will be also indeed when we are present. They say I'm bold in my letter. If they provoke me, I can show them boldness in presence as well. I don't have to be so meek and so humble. I don't have to be so small and so little. I can show you the power of an apostle. He has done it before. He struck Elymas blind. He could certainly demonstrate the authority that he has as an apostle. They should be thinking very carefully about attacking and provoking and poking this bear. Verse 12. For we dare not make ourselves of the number or compare ourselves with some that commend themselves. I'm not like them who are judging themselves by themselves. Oh, you can trust him because I trust him. And then he'll say, well, you can trust him because I trust him. Well, everybody trusts everybody, but nobody's telling the truth. Everybody's lying to everybody. I don't judge myself based on someone else. I judge myself based on the standard of the Word of God. So we dare not make ourselves of the number. I'm not part of that group that of those false teachers who compares themselves and commends themselves with themselves. But they, measuring themselves by themselves and comparing themselves among themselves, are not wise. Nobody ever learns anything. They never grow beyond themselves because they're stopping at just comparing themselves with themselves. And that's not right. He argued against that back in chapter 3, where they would send these letters of resume and qualifications signed and sealed by themselves. Well, what good does that do anyone? Not wise, he says. Verse 13, but we will not boast of things without our measure, but according to the measure of the rule of God. My boasting is not of myself, It is not based on what others say of me. It is based on the rule which God has distributed to us, the inspired word, which he held within himself, but that also which judged him and which kept him on the straight and narrow. A measure to reach even unto you. If you will listen to me, if you will obey the words I'm saying, that gospel which keeps me in line can keep you in line as well. Verse 14. For we stretch not ourselves beyond our measure, as though we reach not unto you. For we are come as far as to you also in the preaching of the gospel of Christ. Our business with you was not to destroy you, but it was to help save you. Our business with you is for the helping of your soul, not the destruction of it. So don't provoke that side of it. Rather, encourage the other side. Encourage the saving. Don't provoke the destruction and the destroying. Versus these false teachers, who's coming to you was certainly not for your benefit, but is much more nefarious. Verse 15. Of himself he says, we, not boasting of things without our measure, we are not just talking the talk, we're also walking the walk. These false teachers, they are, to use a figure of speech, all hat and no cattle. He says, that's not us. We're not boasting of things without our measure, that is, of other men's labors, like they were, taking credit for the work that Paul had done there in Corinth, among other places. But having hope, when your faith is increased, that we should be enlarged by you according to our rule abundantly. In other words, when you grow in the Spirit and grow in grace and knowledge of the truth, I grow spiritually. I gain encouragement. So my entire purpose for preaching and teaching is to see you flourish and to see you grow, whereas theirs is to tear you down, to force you into their rule of law, to force you according to and to submit to their thinking, whereas I am teaching you the Word of Christ. I am teaching the inspired words of God. And so when you grow, that's the only reward I need, whereas they are looking at tearing you down and then using your twisted and warped sense of growth according to their rule of law as motivation to preach to others so that they can have the authority and power. This is not right, he says. My purpose, he says, verse 16, to preach the gospel in regions beyond you and not to boast in another man's line of things made ready in our hand. My purpose is not to brag for no reason or for any reason. My purpose is not to use you to make myself look better for someone else as they are doing, those false teachers. My purpose is to help you grow and then move on to help someone else grow and then move on to help someone else grow. It's not about me. It's about you. These false teachers have made it about them, though, and they need to be rejected. Verse 17, but he that glories, let him glory in the Lord. If you're going to find something to boast in, boast of Christ who gives us the grace of salvation that we have in the first place. If you're going to glory, glory in God, not glory of yourself, not glory of your own labor, of your own work, but glory in God. Verse 18, for not that he commendeth himself is approved. Not he that commends himself is approved. If I spend all my time trying to prop myself up, I won't be approved of God. But whom the Lord commendeth, that person will be approved. If I just submit myself to Christ, act as a servant for Christ, go sow the seed of the kingdom, then whatever growth and whatever benefit comes from the kingdom, even by the working of my hand as a sower, the glory goes to God. The credit goes to God. The praise goes to God. I don't have to worry about, I shouldn't be so insecure as they were in commending myself and in boasting of myself. If I just give all the credit to God, God will bless me. God will give me the just reward, the undeserved blessing of heaven, which is all the credit and all the reward that I need for the work and the labor of myself as a preacher. That's what Paul says. And so without actually saying the words, Paul basically says, compare my attitude to theirs. Compare my motivation to theirs. Now tell me who is doing right and who's doing wrong. My motivation is your help, giving glory to God. Their motivation is your destruction, giving glory to themselves. The contrast is obvious. Who you should listen to, who you should reject. As we pick up chapter 11 next week, Paul will turn inward, and he will talk to them about what he has suffered for them, not to make them feel sorry for him, not for them to pity him, but for them to see that this is someone who is sacrificing for them versus these false teachers who are not willing to do so. So we'll pick up chapter 11 this time next week. It's the longest chapter, probably the best chapter in the book, and we will notice it next week as we near the end of this great study of 2 Corinthians. Until then, thank you so much.